A very good morning to all of you. I presume you had a great past 2 days and you're all amped up and caffeinated for this talk. If not, feel free to interrupt me to make it more interesting if I put you to sleep. But thank you all for listening on this talk. My name is Chetan Conikee. I'm the CTO and founder at an application security company called ShiftLeft. And for the next 50 minutes, we're going to dissect this particular topic pertaining to business logic flaws. It's not a new topic. You know, it was spoken of at broad scope by Jeremiah Grossman from White Hat almost about 5 or 6 years ago. But it's getting more relevant these days because attackers are progressively moving from very simple attacks to enumerating, conducting recon on more complex attacks. All of us are privy to security issues and more privy to vulnerabilities, which OWASP has done a phenomenal job in categorizing and measuring. So I presume that most of you have instruments in your business line where you either proactively measuring for vulnerabilities or perhaps reacting to threats and then prioritizing your vulnerabilities. But let's go ahead and actually define these two broad swath of categories and then double click into business logic flaws. Vulnerabilities have common characteristics across different applications. It is this trait that enables an instrument to be invented to apply across disparate business domains and then measure for your risk associated to a particular vulnerability. The stark difference between this topic of what we're going to discuss, which is design flaws, is they do not have common patterns or signatures or perhaps expressions that you apply that you can measure for or against. Let us use visualizations to essentially describe both of these categories of vulnerabilities. A very simplistic representation of a vulnerability, which is quantified by OWASP, is almost, can be ascribed with a straight line, where you have an attacker who has essentially provisioned a dictionary, and this dictionary contains a series of regular expressions, and these expressions are applied in sequential order in order to exploit your application. But for that, we have to deconstruct your application. You know, every service on the internet is provisioned based on a set of microservices or a single service. But if you draw out a very simple representation of your application, it can be quantified as sources, which are nothing but API endpoints or web routes. These are the points where your consumers and attackers are interacting with your system. Sinks are all exit points in your application, or perhaps re-entry points in your application. Quickly to draw out an example, if your application is interacting with a database, another microservice is using an RPC protocol, these are sinks. And further down, you have security-sensitive sinks, which is when you touch a file system, when you're communicating over the network, it is something that the attacker can leverage during reconnaissance to privilege escalate or move to the next step. And obviously, as good citizens, we apply authorization and validation between our sources and sinks in order to ensure that those interacting with our application are valid users. Often problems arise due to improper usage patterns of those specific APIs. Example, you know, if you're allocating memory and not freeing it, someone could initiate a brute force DOS attack on your application. Or perhaps if your validation routines are not strong enough, someone could bypass those routines and then induce an injection or a buffer overflow attack. And finally, it's just privilege escalation. You know, if you are echoing back certain parameters in your response that an attacker can leverage to understand the characteristics of your application, they can move to the next step. Now let us look at what a business logic flaw actually means, because we have sorts of defined the term, but you know it's still confusing, so let's kind of break it down. When we looked at vulnerabilities, it almost seemed like a straight line where someone is enumerating a source, bypassing your validation, and exploiting a sink. But attackers have evolved. You know, granted that it's ironic that the RSA theme is human element. So in this equation, the human element is the evolution of a typical offensive ethical hacker, or perhaps, you know, a bounty hunter or a non-ethical hacker. They have the necessary instruments to examine the characteristics of your application. And thereafter, they begin to actually hedge on identifying a detour or waypoint in your application. Meaning, if you're using an authorization framework like Okta, an Auth0, or an LDAP system, they have the necessary instruments to enumerate and identify if they could privilege escalate. Or, as we'll see in the next few slides, if you're using a payments provider like Stripe or PayPal, all of those SDKs are available. So someone could understand the characteristics of how your application interacts with these systems. And thereafter, they use those, or essentially weaponize that knowledge to exploit your application. But in order to understand the characteristics and exploit your application, what they need to do is examine the workflow in your application, because that's the fundamental trait that draws the distinction between common vulnerabilities and business logic flaws. Because obviously, if you're working in a particular company, you're building applications that are serving the business purpose. That could be finance, that could be petrochemical or healthcare, et cetera. And you know, typically across all these business domains, you land up using common traits like authorization, payments, and then business-specific domain, which is, you know, if you're using a banking application, you're perhaps dealing with account verification, identity verification, et cetera. So the goal of abusing a business logic flaw is understand what a workflow comprises of, and then figure out ways to sidestep that workflow and abuse your application, which either leads to data exfiltration or taking advantage of a certain trait in your application. So let's double-click into why these flaws emerge. The why is not any different from vulnerabilities. It is because, you know, all of us as good citizens manufacture software at high velocity. You know, there are articles that come out on Google and Facebook that says, embrace chaos engineering. Move fast and break things. So what we all do is learn from the best and then go ahead and actually imbibe those practices. But there are side effects to that. One is, as you evolve at high velocity, you leave behind security. And when you do, there's no documents to exemplify or explain what you're actually doing. And security always gets pinned at the last part of your entire manufacturing process, because you're reacting to an event that either has happened in your cohort space or someone has exploited your application and you've received an email for a bug bounty. And lastly, it's just the nature of architecture, because as we evolve and build our applications, we are architecturing our application for resilience, not so much for security. The good citizens of OWASP have realized that business logic flaws is evolving, attackers are evolving, so they have started categorizing what would it actually mean when we manufacture these instruments to measure business logic flaws. Obviously, any practitioner would like everything to be categorized in an efficient way, so we understand where our weaknesses lie. But when you begin to parse these different terms, you'll slowly gather the context behind it. You know, just to illustrate, you have this business process out of order. That actually means if you have a workflow comprising of step one, step two, step three, step four, can someone move from step one to step four by bypassing two and three? The other is, you know, retrieving password vulnerabilities. That actually implies if someone figures out a way to initiate a password reset on your application, What is the consequence? Would that impact your session? Are you doing something important in that session? So we're going to spend some time breaking this down, but I wanted to draw context that OWASP is now taking it seriously, which implies that soon you will have instruments that are going to measure for this. Cases are always illustrated with visualization. So let's deep dive and understand what this implies, because we spoke of business process of order. So let's break this down with an example. This is an example that actually happened, so I'm going to walk you through this very quickly. It's a scenario from the left where you have an attacker creating two sessions with a particular e-commerce website using a payments provider. The first course of action is login, add a series of items to the checkout. Now, the typical modus operandi of an attacker is to sense the request response patterns. So unlike normal users using browsers, they install an intercept proxy and begin to observe that information exchange. Lo and behold, there is an interesting parameter called as token that is exchanged. That implies that, you know, perhaps you bought a series of items, you were redirected to your payments provider, could be PayPal, Stripe, or Venmo, et cetera. And the consequence of that is you're authorized to conduct that transaction, and it's returned this interesting token. This token is a composite of your payment and a unique identifier. And obviously, given that you authorized, the next step is ship the items. Now, what this adversarial entity can do is spin up another container or separate incognito tab, utilize the same session ID, this composite, which is your token and payable, which is your token, buy us more items, skip the exchange of information between your e-commerce website and that payments provider, and check to see if they can reuse that token for another transaction. And this actually happened. It's a very real case that happened. If we're going to deconstruct what we visually saw, we got to ask ourselves, is this application architecturally compliant to protect from this condition? For that, it is important to identify if every token that is generated as a consequence of a transaction has affinity towards your user ID and your session, which implies that if someone tries to abuse that token as that same user, they cannot, because it's specific to that user ID and specific to that session. So goes to show that architecturally, it's important to define scopes. And when you define scopes, it prevents someone from reusing a certain critical aspect or attribute in your application. So let us look at essentially identifying an adversarial mindset, because, you know, often we learn best when we examine bug bounties, read how an attacker conducted reconnaissance and then exploited a particular application. There is a swath of wealth on BugCrowd and HackerOne. And I'd encourage all of you to read as much as you can on how a particular attack was conducted when it is ethically announced on these channels. Because when you read plenty, you realize you can build a model. And once you build a model, you can build an instrument to measure for it. So often, attackers go through a order loop, or what they call as observe, orient, decide, and act. It's a continuous loop. They're learning how system works, and then they attempt to exploit that system. The first thing is choosing a target business. You know, attackers get better, and they develop core skills when they choose a particular domain like finance or healthcare, and they continue to delve in that domain because the characteristics sorts of become common, and those lines blur. Now, after they choose a particular domain, they use tools to spider that domain, because that's the first step. You'd like to understand what are the APIs and endpoints available on that domain to exploit. Now, as that understanding is gained, then the interaction begins, where they perhaps sign on as a user and begin to interact with a proxy, an intercepting proxy between the browser and that particular entity, which is your service. Now, as that interaction is established, more knowledge is gained of what are the attributes, the parameters, the tokens, everything that is exchanged as a consequence of serving that business need. And finally, the order loop begins, where they manipulate parameters, begin to figure out ways to sidestep a particular process. And again, there is feedback, because you know everything you do on the web is reflected back with a 200 okay or a 404 or a forbidden. So there is natural feedback, and that consequence helps someone figure out what to do next. There are a broad swath of tools, but you know, just to double click, often burp is used as the weapon for both ethical hackers and non-ethical. And there are two steps that are often taken as a part of this order loop, which is observe, orient, decide, and act. The first step is interception, where you intercept by placing an appropriate proxy and identify the characteristics of the application. And then you're gonna figure out ways to sidestep, figure out ways to manipulate attributes in a particular business workflow. Obviously, you can't do it in a non-automated fashion because it takes a lot of work. So there's a module or a plugin in Burp called Repeater, where you take what you learn, you apply it into the repeater, and the repeater takes its course of action in an automated fashion. We spoke of the instrument, we spoke of the categories, but now if we take that categories and just throw it on the wall, you can figure out ways where someone can correlate and connect these entities and then move to the next step of abusing your application. In the OWASP vulnerability world, you would look at each of these categories in isolation. But when you examine the same thing with the lens of a business logic flaw, you begin to connect the dots and see what are the consequences if someone takes a course of action from one category and moves to the next. So let's take another real example that happened almost a decade ago. The first step was to observe functionality, like we spoke of. You know, this happened with a bidding portal. And often in bidding portal, like a Dutch auction portal, someone participates, joins or signs up, and then participates in a bid process. And when they participate, they're gonna specify an amount, and then you have a series of bidders who participate along with that individual. So this website apparently committed the flaw of displaying usernames and email IDs on the dashboard so that there was an awareness of who else is participating in the bidding process. So it so happened that using interception and using observation, the attacker figured out ways of waiting for the last minute of that bidding process and extracting the email IDs or scraping out the email IDs of the fellow bidders and going and initiating a password reset on all of those bidders at that nth minute. What this led to is all of them essentially received their email, their session was terminated, and as a consequence, this attacker was just left alone in the bidding process with the lowest amount, and he or she won the bid. Let's move to another case with you know, another financial provider. You know, this is sorts of, again, happened several times almost 20 years ago. You know, Citibank was one of the first cases, and then it just keeps repeating. We saw it play out with two more financial firms and Jared Jewelers as well. OWASP has categorized this as IDOR, which is insecure direct object reference. Now, typically when we participate in a transaction, there is always an acknowledgement sent to us via email. And when we receive that acknowledgement, there is a link placed, obviously, so that we can go back and visit transaction details. So most of these vendors commit the faux pas of not authenticating that link, which means that, you know, when you click that link, you directly land on the transaction page and you have all those details, which is information leakage. Even worse, when you are created as a user, the transaction pinned to your user ID is guessable because it's a sequential value that was just picked from the database primary key and echoed back or reflected back in that link. That means, first of all, it's not authenticated, and second, someone can enumerate the link without being a professional hacker and start understanding critical details of address and other personal details of other individuals who participate in the system. Now, this is another case that played out perhaps less than a decade ago, which is, you know, often when we practice our businesses, we make critical announcements. Announcements like acquisitions or anything else that is critical to a business domain. And when we are conducting our PR, often that information is prepped and primed a week before, after all the necessary legalese are met. So when this happens, the attacker on the other side is figuring out, because they're continuously spidering your application. And when they do, they discover this link and they can, a week before, trade and take advantage of this particular announcement that's happening. Again, this played out for real. But let's look at evolution. We looked at the past, you know, almost what happened a decade ago, but let's look at what's happening now, you know, and let's examine a few case files. The first, again, I have the hacker link links embedded in each of these presentations, so the presentations are on the website. When you go back home, you can spend some time reading the literature. But this was an interesting attack on GitLab. GitLab, as good citizens like all of us, enabled 2FA for authentication. 2FA implies that you almost have like a mobile channel and you know, a web channel. And typically, as a part of 2FA, you receive an OTP or a one-time password that you can use with your application. The issue with this architecture was that the OTP was not pinned, or there was no affinity of that OTP with the user ID, which means an attacker, like a valid GitLab user, logs in. He senses via interception the OTP. He changes the email ID and uses the same OTP, and he has access to someone else's repository. This played out with Uber. Again, same modus operandi, where you have an attacker who requests a ride, and as a part of the recon process, they sense all the parameters participating in this whole transaction, and particularly starts enumerating by randomizing and just applying a bunch of numbers to each one of them until they land on this one specific one called as payment profile UUID. By adjusting the last three random characters of the payment profile UUID, the ride disappears from the history of both the rider and the driver, but the ride is fulfilled, which means an attacker was availing free rides of Uber perpetually by just adjusting that parameter, and there is no log. So your systems, which is your WAF and your endpoint, is not lighting up because there's no logs. It just wiped out. This is a really interesting one that played out with GitHub. I blogged about it on the website as well. I'd encourage you to read the details, but it's an attack called as Unicode Case Mapping Collusion. Again, all of us as good citizens have international customers when we launch our services. Our core focus is how can we enable our websites to be Unicode to represent different languages? But the issue is if, now typically in websites we have email as the user ID and you have a password which validates the user. In this case, the user embedded a Unicode character in the local part. Suppose it's jill@github.com. The I was a Unicode character. And again, as good citizens, what we do is validate that email to see if it exists in the database. So there was a step in the core logic that case folded or lowercased that entire email. So when that happens, the Unicode I gets converted to I, and the user's validated, but the necessary information via email was sent using the Unicode character. So the attacker was able to induce a password recovery, get that token and that link to the Unicode-based email. There's, again, a great amount of detail on this, but it's a very interesting attack because, you know, that trait exists in most of the workflows that we have in our application. This played out with New Relic. Obviously, every website that provides a service has pricing and packaging, and you have various tiers. And every tier starts with free and then escalates to premium and platinum and everything, so on and so forth. It so happens that, unfortunately, they were reflecting necessary characteristics or parameters that represented the tier. This was a low-hanging fruit because, you know, on feedback, the attacker received this information that says user-level admin, subscription-level professional. Obviously, if you enumerate subscription level, there could be just a finite set of words. You fuzz those, and you figure out ways to escalate. So this bug bounty was announced because this individual just kept moving up tiers and availing service for free. This one's an interesting one as well. It happened with the Zomato. Zomato is like DoorDash. You know, it's one of the services that provides delivery. This particular individual added items to cart and again observed various parameters. And it so happened there was this one little parameter called as cancellation amount. Kind of didn't make sense, but okay, what the hell? It's enumerated that. And when he or she switched that to zero, it canceled or reduced the order amount of that particular order. So he fulfilled that particular order at no cost. And also cancel majority of the history as well. This one's with reverb.com, another interesting attack. Now, typically, you have these gift or loyalty cards that we receive. When we receive them, there is an amount associated with a loyalty card, which implies that we can operate and use or leverage that particular amount to buy goods. This attack, again, is fairly sophisticated because, you know, there's a module called as Turbo Intruder as a part of Burp, which lets you induce simultaneous requests on a system. Because every system is using some degree of concurrency or asynchronous handling. It so happened if three or four requests are induced concurrently, then the system did not know how to react to it, which means that three concurrent requests with three different items were issued, and this individual was able to redeem more than what the gift card was quantified to. Here's another one with Upserve. If you look at that JSON dump, this is feedback received on the browser. So if you have Google developer tools, you can just essentially spin that up and look at these parameters. Typically, when you buy items to a cart, there is a price and quantity. Both of these were reflected, and often the math is applied in order to understand what is the cumulative price. So this individual just adjusted the quantity to minus one, and the price was adjusted to lower than expected, almost landing to zero. We saw a bunch of cases. Obviously, as humans evolve and identify ways to exploit parameters, they're not going to take a series of manual steps. They'll figure out their own ways of automating their instruments so that they repeat the same pattern in specific business domains or across the web. For that, we spoke of parameter manipulation. We spoke of how to substitute different terms. The community is spending a lot of time aggregating those terms for the benefit of good. And that's great because, you know, for the most part, we as ethical hackers can figure out common names that exist, pin them using these tools, and see if our systems are vulnerable or not. But it's not just us that are leveraging these systems, but hackers are too. So you have repositories called as FuzzDB, where you can enumerate for common method names, common API endpoints, common parameters, etc. There is something called as SecList, again, leveraged by offensive teams for red teaming, bug bounties, etc. and sometimes leveraged by adversarial entities as well. There is something called as payload all things. This is a plethora of attack techniques available, and all of them are categorized either from the perspective of your cloud, or if you want to do an open redirect, or you know, an SSRF attack, et cetera. Low-hanging fruit to very advanced. All of these necessary data points are placed in the repo. You could leverage a attack tool by using this information, hopefully for the greater good. And there's another system called as auto repeater. Now, if you have all these pieces of information, obviously, most of these non-ethical and ethical hackers would figure out ways to make their mundane tasks automated. So they leverage a particular plugin that's available called as auto repeater that takes your mundane tasks and make them automated. This is how a typical bounty hunter's tool set looks like. It's kind of oversimplified, but it's a summary of what we spoke of this far. This ODA loop, or observe, oriented, decide, and act, is essentially starting at the intercept part, which is the first step. They're using one or more tools, and this is just a common representation, which is burp, metaspoil, and zap, but everyone's inventing their own tool set. You know, so there are way many tools in that circle in the center. And there is this continuous feedback loop between leveraging the fuzz DBs and the setlists that are open source, or they inventing their own methods, and finally figuring out all the mundane steps and automating it using a particular plugin. Now, given that we spoke of case files, we spoke of the adversarial mindset, now let's switch context and examine how can we detect these flaws as good citizens. Because, you know, obviously we want to take a posture of proactively identifying this before someone abuses this particular condition and then creates a bug bounty on your business. Like we spoke of, logic flaws are not pattern-based. Again, visiting vulnerabilities, they're mostly pattern-based discovery. Because obviously, if you're speaking of cross-site scripting, which is persistent cross-site scripting, it actually means that you're receiving attacker control data from the outside. You're not validating it. You're saving it to your database, and that data is being reflected to your other users on your website. So what you do is you apply a pattern to find that API as a sink and then work backwards. But unfortunately, that same method cannot be applied for logic flaws. Firstly, we need to understand the business domain that we are operating in. And secondly, we got to understand the workflow associated with the business domain, because we are serving a particular need. So how do we operate in that space? So we examine attacker mindset. So let's switch and look at the defender mindset, because defenders learn from attackers, or efficient defenders learn from attackers. The first thing, or the first call of order, is to model your application's navigation graph. Look at how your application behaves. Work with your architects to build specifications so you understand all your endpoints, all your interactions, etc. The other is you apply appropriate tags to understand all your sources, which is your API endpoints, your web routes, and all your outbound communication points, which they often call as waypoints and detours. Because, you know, if you have a web app, it's communicating with your payments provider, your analytics provider, because we live in a SaaS era, which means that we are leveraging a lot of services. So understand your detours from your application out and in. Once you do, you begin to assess how information is exchanged between your app and the rest of the services or your trusted third parties that you're availing. Now, finally, take all those attack tools that we spoke of and figure out ways to internally leverage them to see if you can exploit your own applications. Sorts of gives you a proactive posture. Before you build your application and you deploy it in your test or staging, take your red team, leverage all what the attackers do, and see whether you can actually pinpoint these conditions. And finally, build a tracker to understand how all this information is exchanged. Can it be sidestepped? Can it be exploited, et cetera? So we spoke of this, as we looked at that previous slide. But visually, it almost looks like this. You have API endpoints, your application is a complex maze of conditions, and then it detours out to your trusted third parties where that information is exchanged. The reason I'm going to park here for a while is because we earlier touched on this point and we affirmed that business logic flaws do not have common traits and specific to your business. But now I'm sort of refuting that statement to a certain extent that if you examine various businesses, what is common is your trusted third-party providers. You tend, whether you're operating in a healthcare or finance or e-commerce, you tend to leverage the same authentication provider or perhaps the same notifications and alerts provider. So these are the common traits, and that's what the attacker is trying to figure out, you know, because they start with the common and then go to the specific. So as good stewards, like to summarize, what we need to do is gather as much information about our application and then work with our security teams to effectively figure out how these workflows can be abused. Because it can be very complex or simple, but when you have a model in front of you, it's easier to infer those relationships and then identify how it can be manipulated. To close, we look at two threat models. Again, this played out really. This is pertaining to a particular identity provider. You know, there are plenty of identity providers or SSO providers like Okta and Auth0 and Google SSO, et cetera. If you look at the typical workflow between your business and such a provider, if you happen to leverage any one of these, is you log in, your consumers log into your website, and then you have that little button that says, you know, use your existing profile through one of these providers. And as a consequence, you redirect it to that provider where you add your user ID and password. And as a consequence, there is a auth assert token along with a redirect URI, meaning as you set up the business between your business domain and that provider, you provide that redirect so that after the identity is validated, the user is transferred back to your business. So this happened a few years ago where such a provider did not create an affinity between the particular merchant, the user ID, and the token. So as a consequence, the attacker could reuse that token by sidestepping this authentication process. And substitute another user or get information to the other users. This played out with a payments provider. Again, if you look at the parts highlighted in yellow, you have the typical consumer visiting a URI, which is of your web service, add items to the shopping cart, and then at that junction of payments, which is the last, second but last step, you'd redirect it to a Stripe or a PayPal, and in this case it's PayPal, where as a consequence of this redirect, there was merchant ID, cost, and redirect URI all exposed by that particular service leveraging PayPal. Now, all of these critical parameters can be manipulated in creative ways, which goes to show that PayPal did a good job, but it's just the company using PayPal exposed certain aspects which should not have been exposed, which is the merchant ID and perhaps transaction ID and the token and everything else that is critical to that business line. So this is just a summary of what we spoke of. You know, as you examine your business, examine all the steps that comprise of your service representing your business. Figure out ways of what are the parameters that influence each of these steps. And then establish an understanding of how one step depends on the other and whether a particular step can be bypassed as a consequence. So on closing, I'd say make security critical. Make it as a part of your early development process. Do not react to it, because when you react, it's hard to create a coordination space between your AppSec teams and your developers to triage and address the issue. With that, I close. Thank you very much. Happy to take any questions.
You mentioned an OWASP project in progress. What's the name of the project?
They haven't settled on the name as yet because it's almost a work in progress at this moment. So if you visit the OWASP webpage, you'll notice a lot of documentation where a lot of thought process is forming right now. And I'm happy to actually add that page. I didn't, I apologize for that, but there are a series of specifications that are available, which is mostly work in progress, like a Wikipedia.
Oh, you're talking about in different sections.
Exactly.
Yeah, I was wondering if they're
condensed into one area. Not as yet. They're creating thoughts before they actually converge. Absolutely.
Because the automated tools can go find 15 things or whatever.
Exactly.
But these are much easier because, yeah, somebody doesn't necessarily need any special tools. They can just manually run through it.
Exactly.
And so I'm kind of desperate for any kind of data that would show these kind of attacks are more severe, if you will, the prevalence of them, and that these methods are necessary because we always run back to just DAS and SAS.
Exactly.
So, anyway, that's just a frustration I personally have. I don't know if you know of any resources that would kind of help make that business case.
There's a series of tools available. I mean, to your point, there is no Swiss Army knife. You know, if someone, some vendor's pitching it, don't believe them. You know, first of all, Swagger is a good start. You know, if you document your API, you know, there are tools that enable you to extract your API from legacy apps, and then by first principles, when you're building apps, you ask your engineers to conform to Swagger, because you establish proper documentation in your sources.
Well, the frustrating thing is that's usually half the code, right? So there's a piece of Swagger that allows you to redesign.
Yeah, exactly.
It's about switching that mindset. So then you're in a pen test mode, but then that code shifts, right? So
exactly.
Yeah, so this is more of a comment than a question. I usually, by policy, don't do that. But to follow up on some of your discussion, I'm a technical lead for the Common Weakness Enumeration, CWE, and I've found business flaws, business logic flaws, very interesting from that perspective. And one thing that I've theorized, but maybe you can comment on, is that I think there are certain kinds of mechanisms that can help inadvertently address business logic flaws. For example, on the pricing forms and so on, which were manipulated, you would have quantities that you would expect to be one or greater.
Absolutely.
And it seems to me like input validation frameworks, if you were knowledgeable that what you were expecting as an input was a quantity, then appropriate input validation, so to speak, might inadvertently help you in protection against at least those kinds of issues. So
excellent point.
I was wondering what you think about it. It feels to me, anyways, like static code analysis tools and so on are perhaps underutilized in a way or unrecognized.
Excellent point.
From a perspective of business logic flaws. So what's
excellent
your
point. Excellent
that?
Point. I think you hit the nail on its head. I've been doing a lot of research in that area, and ShiftLeft is built on this genesis of next generation code analysis, where we said code analysis evolved 20 years ago, but can it be at a place now where it's applicable to the newer workloads? But if you look at the construct of code analysis, it derives a lot from how compilers compile your code, which is every app program has a syntax tree, control flow, and data flow, right? But when all of these three are separate, it doesn't tell you a story. But when you merge it together, you can begin to extract interesting nuggets of information. Firstly, establish how data flows, figure out waypoints and detours in your application. Because if you look at any application's package repository or its open source dependencies, you can quickly imply it's using a SDK of a authentication provider or a payments provider. And now you gleam at the API, you mark that or tag that as an exit or entry point, and then figure out a flow, and then identify parameters that are influencing the flow.
Hi, are there any, you had the great image about control flow within a program, and as the first person to ask questions also pointed out that usually, well, you have to code, but I very rarely get any of diagrams. So basically, do you have any good tooling that to point towards where, for example, with legacy, you could take the code and turn that into a workable image about data flow, control flow within that program? The worst example that comes to mind was a legacy program that had a 1,000-line index.cgi with a phase is parameter that had documented values of 10 and 20 and 40 and 30, but it also had in the code was phase is 666, that which was added later as an exceptional case. I think there was a minus one also. So basically, looking at the documentation, which was not diagrams, was just text, and looking at the horrific long index CGI, it's like, okay, I really would like to test the business logic on that thing, but I wouldn't know where to start, and it would take me a couple of weeks to understand.
Great question. If I have to echo back your question, I have a legacy app. Now, can I construct a graph of that legacy app and then work backwards? Because that's a starting point for someone to assess where the flaws lie. When I co-founded ShiftLeft, our entire foundation was based on an academic project called this code property graph. Three words. You Google it, you'll get enough information on the dissertation. It was invented by our chief scientist, Dr. Yamaguchi, because he essentially hit all the roadblocks with static analysis tools. So the reason of this invention was, how can you take code, convert it to a graph that combines the syntax, the control, and the data into one representation? Now, the second part that you emphasized on is legacy. Because, you know, we are in the era of big data, right? Which means that you could have maybe 20 million lines of code. Now, can that be represented efficiently in memory or disk? So obviously a graph is the best representation, because, you know, Google and Facebook has leveraged the graph. So that's what we did. You know, we built a system that can analyze any code base written in majority of the programming languages. We convert that into a graph. And using the graph, you created a query language, just like Jupyter or any data science system, where you can model and assess all these conditions.
So code property graphs was
yes,
the tool.
Code property graph. So we have created an open source version called Yoern, J-O-E-R-N, specifically focused on C and C++. But for the rest of the languages, we have a commercial tool called as Ocular. It's almost like a Jupyter or any data science toolkit, where you bring it into your private space, you convert your program written in Java or Golang or any of these new programming languages into the graph. You load the graph into that research space, and then we have created a series of queries for you, so you don't have to write it. And most of our queries are learned from examining bug bounties. We examine, we classify, and we take that complexity, represent these as navigations on the graph. And then we extract the conditions to let you know whether you're susceptible to such an attack or not. Ocular, O-C-U-L-A-R. Great. So that's a wrap. I think we are close to time. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.